Hey, it's Noah from Tessa.com, and I'm here at the Neutral Buoyancy Lab, NASA's Neutral Buoyancy Lab in Houston, Texas. This is where NASA trains astronauts before they can go to space. I'm here with Terry Dunn, you're the Training Operations Manager. And Terry, we're in front of a spacesuit.
Right, this is the extravehicular mobility unit, or EMU as we call it. And it's the spacesuit that astronauts wear for spacewalks, either the space shuttle back in those days or the space station now.
And so this is in use, this is in the design that's been used for decades.
Right, it's essentially unchanged for the past 40 years.
Now, we've seen what the spacesuit kind of looks like, you know, in photos and videos, but we don't really know what goes underneath and how an astronaut actually puts on the suit. Can you show us the different components of a spacesuit and all the various different accessories that they put on?
Well, sure, this is really just the outer layer, and it starts with a few things that we have over here. Now, on this table, we have the components that go inside of the suit, starting with the diaper.
Underwear, in space, but it's a diaper.
Right, and it's big enough for an adult, but it's the same purpose. And ideally, you're not gonna have to use it, but in reality, you're gonna be in that suit about 6 hours, so.
And this is only worn when you're in going to wear a spacesuit.
Right.
And not when you're just floating around the ISS. Up to them.
Right, personal preference, I suppose. But when you gotta go, you gotta go. Now, over the diaper, you're gonna have basically off-the-shelf cotton long johns.
All right,
so
cotton's fine?
Right, and the idea is that it's gonna wick away any sweat that you have in there so that your body doesn't get slippery and you're not gonna puddle sweat at the bottom of the suit. So you would have the pants and then also a long sleeve shirt that would go over that.
Sounds good, sounds like everything I could buy at a supermarket right now.
Right, so far you're good.
Yeah.
You're ready to go into space. Next, you're gonna get derailed a little bit. This is the liquid cooled ventilation garment. And basically it's a jumpsuit with very stretchy material, but woven in through that material are tubes that run cold water. So by varying the flow rate of that cold water, you can manage your body temperature. You can imagine with all this stuff underneath and then all the stuff you're gonna put on the outside, you get hot very quickly, especially if you're working outside.
And so it's just through these tubes here and it's designed so those are the points where heat can be released more effectively.
Right, it's distributed well enough that you don't feel point cooling. It's basically an overall effect.
Okay.
And then we've got the communication cap, and this is really kind of a NASA trademark. This is the Snoopy cap that you've read about forever. And if you'd like, you may try it on.
I will. Wow, all right, so this plugs in then?
This will plug into a port on the suit, and then you've got electrical power, and there's a radio built in that lets you talk to the guys back inside the space station and indirectly back down to mission control. We would also have a few other ancillary items that are kind of at the discretion of the astronaut. They'll be wearing cotton gloves that go underneath the regular gloves. And again, it's the same idea as the undergarments. You're just gonna wanna wick away the sweat underneath. And then we also have a variety of pads and shields that help limit any contact with the metal inside the suit so you don't get soft spots and bruising while you're in there. And this would be an example of those.
All right, and then after they put all this on, they put on the EMU.
Right, the outer part of the suit.
All right, let's go check that out. Since we're here at the NBL, these suits are used for training purposes. How does this suit differ than what the astronauts actually wear on the ISS?
Well, if you take away the life support system, which is the backpack-looking thing up here, there's really no difference. In fact, a lot of the hardware that we use here for training is hardware that's flown in space before.
Been in space and repurposed as training.
Right. I like to think it's been upgraded for training, but they call it downgrading for training.
An astronaut would have to disassemble it from it hanging on a wall before putting it on.
Right. They would want to break it down into the same components like we have here.
And what do they put on first?
The first thing you're going to do is put on the lower torso assembly, which to you and me would be a pair of pants with the shoes built in. They call it spacewalking, but you don't use your legs a whole lot when you're spacewalking. So they would put this on, and it gets pulled up to about their waist. And once they've got that, they're going to waddle underneath this. Like in space, it's not waddling. They're going to float underneath here. And then squat through the bottom of this upper torso assembly, which is rigidly mounted to the inside of the space station, and then get their arms up through here, and their head will pop out of the top. And then at that point, they're in the suit.
And this is a very rigid suit. Like, there's not a lot of mobility in here.
Right, the upper part, they call it the hard upper torso for a reason. It's really a hard shell, and despite the obvious comfort level of that, there's a reason for it. And you've got to have all these different things. The life support system, the controls for the suit, your tools, all have to be rigidly mounted. So you need that hard shell to be able to do that.
What are the materials that are used for the EMU? It's many different materials and layers, I imagine.
Right, there's a few different composites that I can't explain all the details of.
State secrets.
Right, the different composites that make up the hard upper part, and then several layers of materials that make up the bladder part as well.
So they have the upper unit, and then what's next?
They're going to button these two pieces together, and they'll have an assistant that helps them do that. The bottom part is attached to the upper part here, and then they'll put on gloves. Ah. And I've got one here if you'd like to try that on.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. It's right-handed. It's a very, very tight fit in there. And the gloves are customized to some extent?
To a degree. These components, the lower torso assembly and the hard upper torso, you really get small, medium, and large, and you'd get the best fit within that. For the gloves, we've got dozens of different sizes. So while we don't necessarily make custom gloves for every person, there's a variation that we get pretty close with just about everybody.
Yeah, and what's an important feature of the glove, you know, in terms of usability, functionality, and safety?
There's a fine line between the dexterity that they have to be able to do a job and the comfort of the fit. So my opinion, and I'm sure a lot of people would disagree, is that a little bit of pain is just right. That means you're getting the best dexterity you can out of that glove. If it's too comfortable, you're probably missing a little bit of the nuance of being able to work.
Hmm. So if you've got to turn a screw 100 times, then...
Right. You don't want the glove in your way.
And then both gloves on, and finally the helmet then.
Right, and then the helmet.
All right. Whoa, it's very echoey in here.
Right. Now, when you're really in the suit, you've got the air flowing through. You're probably not going to notice that. You've got a lot of materials in there that would damp that sound.
And so, with the helmet on, the helmet doesn't turn when the astronaut's head turns.
That's right. Your field of view is very limited. So is your situational awareness.
And so you can basically look almost all the way to your right and left, and then you need to be able to look down as well?
Correct. So if you need to see beyond those views, you're turning your whole torso, like you're in traction, to be able to do that. Now, and by your right ear, there's a knob. Twist that forward.
And that's the visor.
Right. There's also one by your left ear. And that would be more of a shield to keep direct sun away from you. And when you're in space and you don't have the atmosphere kind of filtering out the light, the sunlight is very bright.
And what material is this, the visor, made out of?
That's just regular polycarbonate.
Oh.
Lexan plastic.
Very, very cool.
Well, that's the anatomy of a spacesuit. Attached to the spacesuit is life support unit and different tools then.
Right. On the back would be the life support system, and on the front would be the tools that they use. And that's all stored in another lab.
All right. Well, let's go check those out as well.
All right.
Okay, Terry, so these are the astronauts' tools.
It's a small selection they have available. Yes, this is what they would use.
And this, what is this device here?
This is called the mini workstation, and this part would attach directly to that hard upper torso that we were looking at.
Plug right in.
Right, and you can think of this as their tool belt.
So okay.
Most of the stuff they'll use on any given spacewalk, they would try to store on here to keep it handy.
And they could choose from a different selection of tools on the space station before they go on the spacewalk.
Right, they would decide based on whatever tasks they're gonna do that time.
So give me an example of some of the tools they use.
What we have here is a basic ratchet wrench, and it's a lot like the ratchet wrench you would use at home. It's a 3/8 drive. The main difference is being, you've got a big wheel in the back. So if you're gonna be in a tight space operating this, you don't wanna have to reach down and turn the socket like you would at home. You can get that glove and put it on the back here and turn it that way. And also, you've got a nice big handle down here that gives you plenty of gripping strength, and it's ridged. Now, another feature is they have a cheater bar. They can clip this into the bottom, and you've got the same sort of handle down here, but now you've pretty much doubled your moment arm, so you can really put a lot of torque onto something. And at this point, you have to be careful that you're not gonna break either the bolt or the head of the socket wrench.
And so, just turning a socket in space, it's different than doing it on Earth.
The socket is turning you as much as you are turning the socket.
Right.
So, a lot of times, it's gonna be a one-handed operation where you're gonna use one hand to stabilize yourself while the other hand does the work. Or you have the option of using a foot restraint that would hold you in place.
Do all these tools have to be tethered to the astronaut at all times, or is it okay for them to have it in free hand?
No, they never want to have it just relying on their grip to keep it there. So we have these equipment tethers that, if they're doing their job correctly, any tool that they're using is always going to be attached to one of these tethers.
And then if they wanted to change out a head or a different socket, then they go this side?
Right. They have a number of different sockets they could choose from, again, depending on what they want to do. and they would be stored on something like this. We call a socket caddy. And so you have a pin, you would insert it into this hole in the socket. And so now both of these are tethered. Mm-hmm. You move it over to the wrench.
And you've procedure. Got
it. Right, so at no point was that socket free to float away.
Wow. There you go, that's the astronaut's tool belt. Their extended daily carry, if you will, when they're out outside the space station.
Right.
And then all this plus the EMU is how they survive and operate and work when they're in space. Very cool. Thank you so much, Terry. We'll have more from NASA and Johnson Space Center and the NBL on Tessa.com. I'm Norm. I'll see you next time. Bye.
Take a picture of you doing a recording video. That was an old video game reference.